We return to combat the undead in Resident Evil 3 Nemesis. Nemesis was released only a year after the launch of Resident Evil 2. Despite the similar development time between the first and second game, Nemesis has a substantial number of enhancements, making it the best Resident Evil game on the PlayStation. The story returns to the perspective of Jill Valentine shortly before the events of Resident Evil 2. The game shows the Raccoon City Police Department trying to subdue the zombie outbreak, and that goes about as well as you probably would think. Meanwhile, Umbrella sends in a mercenary team that has a mission to rescue citizens, and in the midst of all this chaos, Jill decides to get the hell out of the city. While leaving, she comes across Umbrella mercenary team member Carlos Oliveira. However, complicating Jill's escape is a new Umbrella experiment called Nemesis. Nemesis has just one goal, and that's to kill all of the remaining STARS members left in the city. The story is somewhat similar to the first game in that you had to escape from the Spencer Mansion, and here you're trying to escape from Raccoon City. The focus on Jill trying to escape rather than confront Umbrella also kind of makes more sense here. Jill has already survived this nightmare before, watching her friends die. All she wants to do is get the hell away from it all. The one negative here is that you can't pick your character to experience a unique version of the story. You have to play as Jill, though you do get to control Carlos for a while. The enemies in the game are a collection of the monsters from the past games. Zombies, hunters, lickers, worms, crows, and spiders are all over the place this time. There are a few boss fights, but the inclusion of Nemesis more than makes up for it. Unlike other boss fights where you get trapped in a room and you have to keep blasting them until they die, Nemesis works a bit differently. He pops up at random times, and running to another room is no longer a guaranteed safety net. Nemesis can break down walls and doors, and what makes him more of a threat is his speed. Dude is flipping fast. It's your choice whether you want to engage him or not, but more often the challenge here is to try and get the hell away from him before he picks Jill up and crushes her skull in. The gameplay has also had a few changes. Most of the changes relate to the rigid inventory system. Jill now has up to 10 slots, making picking things up much easier, and this also makes the storage bins feel like they are relied on a lot less than in the past two games. The first big change is now that Jill can pick up gunpowder and create ammo. Depending on which powder you pick up and which ones you choose to mix, it will decide what and how much ammo you'll end up with. Weapons function pretty much the same, with there being upgrades for some of them, in addition to Jill's assault rifle, which now works on a percent meter. Also, picking up first aid sprays are much easier, since Jill can now store up to 3 of them in a small pack. The biggest change in regard to the game design is that the backtracking is handled much better. Jill has more freedom to move around the ruins of Raccoon City trying to find the one way out. Usually the one way requires you to solve a puzzle that might require multiple pieces. For instance, in order to get to the next area of Raccoon City, the clock tower, Jill has to find 3 objects to fix up a tram car. And the objects are hidden in 3 different areas around the current zone, and you have to solve a bunch of puzzles on the way to get to these 3 items. However, this never feels as tedious as the backtracking was in the first game. Jill will rarely come across locked doors that require 5 different keys in order to make any progress. Much like in Resident Evil 2, there's a better sense of moving forwards, even if you find yourself revisiting the same areas. This design helps as it makes what backtracking there is never feel like busy work. Also, I have to talk about one of the puzzles. I haven't really been mentioning the puzzles in the past reviews since they're pretty simple in their nature. However, Nemesis has one of the most annoyingly frustrating puzzles I have ever come across in a video game, and it happens right near the end of the game. Jill will have to place a water sample into a machine and match the code. Sounds simple enough, but this puzzle requires you to match a series of bleeps and bloops by turning dials, and there's no smart or logical way to solve this other than just randomly turning the dials and hoping for the best result. And I'm not gonna lie here, I used a guide to get past this puzzle the first time I played. The controls have also received some upgrades. The core controls are still the same, tank controls and stiff shooting, nothing new there. However, there are 2 new features that greatly accompany the shortcomings of the basic controls. Jill can now perform 180 degree turns, which greatly helps during fights with Nemesis when you need to make a quick escape. It's also much easier than having to slowly rotate your way around. Also, Jill can now perform a dodge move just before she gets hit, and this addition is awesome as Jill will jump or dodge right out of the way, leaving you to take a free shot on whatever's attacking you. Finally, those damn devil dogs and their unnatural jumping ability can suck it. This ability is greatly used in the fights with Nemesis, whereas in Resident Evil 2, Claire had to often take hits from Mr. X since she wasn't fast enough, Jill can simply slip out of the big guy's way. Nemesis makes up for its lack of selectable protagonists by introducing the Mercenaries mode after completing the game. In this mode, you play as Carlos or one of the other Umbrella Mercenaries as you attempt to reach an evacuation zone. And the main goal here is not solving puzzles to make progress, but to blast every undead monster in sight to gain more time to reach the evacuation site. And this mode is a lot of fun, I just wish it was available right at the start of the game rather than having to complete it first. The presentation is just on par with what was seen in Resident Evil 2. They're very detailed pre-rendered backgrounds and character models. There's also a lot more diversity to the areas that Jill will be moving through. The ruined streets of Raccoon City, a hospital, car garage, chemical plant, cemetery, park, and sewers all get explored. The soundtrack as usual excels in creating a sense of dread and terror as you move around the ruins of the city. In regards to the voice acting, it's miles better than the first game on the PlayStation, and slightly better than the last game. Most of the dialogue here is handled by Jill and Carlos, and thankfully their voice actors are not as dreadful. Overall, Resident Evil 3 Nemesis feels more like a step forward for the series rather than a sidestep. Resident Evil 2 was good and all, but it changed very little from the core mechanics of the first game. Nemesis brings in new controls, a refined inventory system, and less focus on heavy backtracking through the same areas over and over again. When I first played Resident Evil and its sequel, I was frustrated over their controls, backtracking, and their inventory systems, as I've mentioned. However, when I first played Nemesis, I didn't run into these problems at all. I generally had a lot more fun in the early hours, which is why I clearly think Nemesis is the best Resident Evil title on the PlayStation. So come back next time as we find out what Claire Redfield's been up to when we look at Resident Evil Code Veronica.